Thank you very much for the invitation to participate in this forum. I'm delighted to be here to talk about how we manage our patients with 17p deletion, particularly in the sense of patients treated with ibrutinib. So here are my disclosure slides. And let's talk a little bit about 17p. So whenever you see a patient with a 17p deletion, they usually have read the internet and they know that it's one of the worst outcomes, not only in terms of median overall survival, which was reported as 32 months compared to everyone else, which is much longer, but also in terms of median time to treatment, which is only 9 months in this particular study from Donner and colleagues in Germany. So these patients have a more aggressive form of disease, and unfortunately, we didn't have anything to treat them up until very recently. So how do we diagnose these patients? We know that cytogenetics or karyotyping may miss a 17p deletion, and that's why we all use FISH analysis to determine whether or not they carry the 17p deletion. What some people may not know or may not use yet, in this sense, Europeans are a little bit ahead of us, is that patients may not have a 17p deletion, and yet they may have a TP53 mutation. So one doesn't mean that correlates with the other. There are certain patients, a minority of them, which may have a TP53 mutation and yet not have a deletion 17P by FISH analysis. So what you see here is that the minority of patients at early stage disease carry either a 17P deletion or a TP53 mutation. This is a clonal evolution event. And as we are closer to requiring therapy, this percentage increases, and then when you become fludarabine refractory, you are totally enriched. Certain series call it 30%, others 50%, but on average, it's in between those numbers. And then whenever you have a patient with a Richter transformation, this percentage goes through the roof. So the more aggressive the disease is, the more chances that you have a TP53 mutation or a 17P deletion. Now, these are the landmark study by the Germans. I'm sorry. I know. Here, this is the landmark study by Donner et al. Showing the overall survival for patients with deletion 17P. And here you see the study from the German CLL study group where they tested frontline therapy for patients with CLL and the outcomes that they had whenever they were treated with F or FC. If you had a 17P deletion or a TP53 mutation, your outcome was essentially the worst. And this is the reason why Stefan Silgenbauer, a decade after Donner presented this data, call this group of patients an ultra-high-risk group. Just historically, what we know is that patients treated with FCR, which is the more aggressive chemoimmunotherapy regimen that we have for our young patients that are fit to tolerate it, patients go into remission on average 11 to 12 months. So that was historically the best thing that we had. And even then, these patients would still relapse. What happened is on the first time when we started trials with ibrutinib in 2010, what we saw was that patients with 17P not only responded well to ibrutinib, but also they were in remission much longer than what we had seen up until then with historical controls. And at the first time that this data was presented, you saw that even though they were in remission longer than in historical controls, 17P deletion patients were still the ones that were the first to relapse. So yes, they do respond to ibrutinib, but unfortunately, ibrutinib doesn't work forever for some of these patients. So that's the reason why these patients are still high-risk disease. Now, a longer-term follow-up, what we found was that the patients that did drive this curve to relapse sooner were the patients with a 17P deletion, and some groups are now projecting that part of it is having a complex karyotype. That's still too early, and the data is not mature enough, but it's interesting to note that most of the patients with a 17P deletion also have a complex karyotype. On median progression-free survival for a patient treated with ibrutinib in this trial was 28 months for patients with a 17P deletion. Here, patients, there were very few patients on the treatment-naive arm that had a 17P deletion, and only one of them did relapse, like you heard earlier from Rick Furman when he said that this patient ended up having a Richter transformation, which we're not sure if the patient had a preceding Richter transformation that was not clearly noted by the time that started on therapy. Now, this is the data from the NIH. Dr. Mohamed Farouki and colleagues did a study comparing patients with or without 17p. And what he found was that ibrutinib worked identical on both groups. The difference was that the time to clear the 17p lymphocytes took longer. So as you can see here, he reported 91% here for patients with normal 17p, and with deletion 17p, 96%. The big difference was the red chunk of patients which had long-standing lymphocytosis. So the ibrutinib clears the bone marrow, clears the spleen, and clears the peripheral blood. The problem is that it takes longer. And in essence, he also showed the same as the other phase one trial in this single institution study, where patients that relapsed sooner were the patients that had the deletion 17p. So we know the drug works. The problem is these are still our patients that do relapse sooner. So then came the Resonate 17 study, which was presented by Susan O'Brien and colleagues in ASH 2014. This is the largest study ever presented on patients with a relapse refractory 17p deletion. They had to have documented deletion 17p by peripheral blood flow, and 144 patients were treated with ibrutinib from the moment of a beginning continuously until progression or toxicity. By investigator assessment, the response rate was reported at 83%, which was the primary endpoint. And by IRC assessment, it was 65. Bear in mind, IRC assessment requires two different CAT scans at two different time points. And that's the reason why the reported overall response rate is a little bit lower. It's only because it takes time, as you have heard before, to get a better response. The longer you're on the drug and the longer you wait, the better your response rates. In terms of progression-free survival, at the time of the presentation of this study, the median follow-up had been 11.5 months. And overall response, median progression-free survival at 12 months was 79%. But it's interesting to note, patients with a higher tumor burden of 17p had a shorter time in remission. And the same with overall survival. Patients with higher tumor burden of 17p deletion cells or deleted cells had a shorter time of overall survival on average. Now, Stefan Silkenbauer last year at ASH gave an update on this data. He did not give an update on the overall response rate or the median follow-up. However, he did risk stratify and reported the outcomes based on genetic features. So we know that 16% of the patients had an 11q deletion, 84% of the patients had unmutated IGVH, and these are the genomic variants that were noted. Interesting to note, there were three patients with a PLC gamma mutation and one patient with a BTK mutation. And if you may remember from the earlier talks, these are the mutations that confer resistance to ibrutinib. So as you can see here on the overall response rate, any bad characteristic that is described here, mutated ATM, NOTCH1, SF3B1, they all responded equally well to ibrutinib. And these are the patients that had less than four patients on each genetic variant. The patients that had before taking ibrutinib, PLC gamma mutation or BTK mutation, had never received in their lifetime a BTK inhibitor or a PI3K delta inhibitor. And these variants have never been linked to ibrutinib resistance before. So this is a different mutation, for example, in the BTK than the ones that we have seen when they become refractory. So this is still, you know, something that we need to understand and study, because not all BTK mutations may be the same. And some BTK mutations may still respond to ibrutinib. Now, the other interesting concept was that survival outcomes were consistent and encouraging across all the bad markers. However, patients with a mutated ATM, there may be a difference, but the number was too small. Only 14% of the patients had an ATM mutation. And it was also interesting to note that patients with a bulkier disease did tend to relapse sooner. So there might be a point of no return or a point where the drug doesn't work as well if you have bulky disease defined as more than 5 centimeters in diameter. So in terms of side effect profile, we have heard it in earlier talks, this drug may be associated with atrial fibrillation, and we anywhere reported from 8 to 10%, and it has been seen that on the randomized control trials, we see a higher incidence of patients developing atrial fibrillation on the patients that took ibrutinib. The way that we traditionally manage it is just, you know, contact cardiology, and if they need to be started anticoagulation, we discuss the pros and the risks and the benefits with the patients, and then we make a decision about it. There is data on concomitant anticoagulation and ibrutinib use. In terms of bleeding events, the majority of them are very, very mild, grade 1. There's a minority of them that have a grade 2 or grade 3 defined as intracranial hemorrhage, vitreal hemorrhage, or spontaneous hematoma. And only one patient had tumor lysis syndrome, but this occurred in this particular study after progression of disease when the patient had been exposed to a different compound, so it's not supposed to be due to ibrutinib itself. Now, over time, after 3 years, we're seeing some quality of life events that happen when we are on this drug. So all the drugs come with their own array of side effects that you need to be aware in order to discuss with your patient, like the patient that was presented before that had this self-decreased the dosage. Here you can see some patients may have hypertension, and this is something that we're seeing more and more often as the longer the patients are on study. The other thing is atrial fibrillation events seem to happen earlier in the course of the therapy. In terms of infection risk, the majority of patients that develop an infection are usually patients with relapsed refractory disease. As you can see here, about half can develop an infection while on therapy. Most patients with treatment-naive disease don't have this. Arguing to the potential idea that the sooner you treat with ibrutinib, you might be avoiding some of the side effects and toxicities usually associated with the use of chemoimmunotherapy regimens that may damage the T cells to the point of a severe immunocompromised state, leading to more infection risk. Now, this data was presented by Jennifer Brown and colleagues in ASH 2014. This is the data from the RESONATE trial, ibrutinib against ofatumumab in patients with relapsed refractory CLL. What you see here, patients with ofatumumab, regardless of whether they had one prior therapy or more therapies, there was no different in outcomes in terms of remission duration. However, there was a big difference that was statistically significant in patients that were randomized to ibrutinib. If they had only one prior therapy, chances were they were going to still be in remission long-term. If they had more than one prior therapy, they were most likely going to relapse sooner. We think that the reason why this happens is because people do get clonal selections for some of those chromosomal aberrations that we know can cause you to stop responding to the drug sooner, like 11q deletion, 17p, or complex karyotype, clonal evolutions that we know accumulate over time after multiple prior regimens. Now, over time, we are also seeing that the percentage of the T cells, including CD4, CD8, improve while on the drug ibrutinib, and over time, there's no statistical significant change in the immunoglobulins or any subtype of immunoglobulin. Now, in terms of bleeding events that we have been talking, Dr. Jeffrey Jones presented all the events, and as you can see, very few of them are a grade 2 or grade 3. The majority are grade 1. So these include petechia, contusion, epistaxis. For the most part, it's just cosmetic. We don't do anything. We don't stop the drug for these grade 1 events. We do alter it before any surgery. We ask the patients to stop the drug 3 to 7 days before, depending on the intensiveness of the surgery, like how aggressive the surgery will be. If you expect a lot of vascularity, we usually err on the side of caution. But for the most part, you can tell the patients that there is data from this study where patients were concomitantly taking aspirin or anticoagulants or antiplatelet agents. Now, this is one of my patients on ibrutinib, never taking any aspirin or Plavix or warfarin, and she looks as if she had warfarin skin, you know, ecchymosis. She also likes to go in the sun, but this patient has 17P, previously refractory to FCR and BR, so she really doesn't care that she has these changes and hyperpigmentation on her skin. So she really doesn't even cover her arms. For most of my patients, these changes in the skin do change, but she still likes to go out in the sun, so I think that's the reason why she still has it after 6 months of therapy. So with that, thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to answer any questions.